Vicki Wood came to one of our meets two years ago.
I can tell you a story about Vicki Wood. In 1957, our research people did an experimental Chrysler 300 that they brought down. They wanted to run it in an experimental division on the beach. Ed Mason and Anyway, they came down and they were going to run the beach. Bob Graham. So I hired Buck Baker for $1,000 to run the car up and down the beach. It was only going to be probably an hour's of his time to run down and come back, wait in line and run. So on the morning that we're going to make the speed run with Ed and Bob Graham's car engine, we're moving, nobody, Buck isn't there. We're moving the car forward in the line. And then we move it forward in the line and Buck still hasn't shown up. And so we're frantically, my guys are frantically trying to find out where Buck is. Well, they learned that he signed with Chevrolet and he isn't going to show. He's going to be a no-show. So here we are, this car's moving forward, and at that time, we didn't think it was a good idea for factory people to be in a Daytona speed event. Looking back at it, I don't think that was so bad. But we didn't think it was a good thing to do. So Vicki was available. So, and I don't remember what we paid Vicki, but probably not $1,000. So Vicki was available. We hired Vicki, had never been in the car before, and she got in that car, and we're moving the car forward, and she looked at the speedometer, and she said, it says 200 miles an hour. I said, Vicki, it won't go that fast. I mean, I think she was a little apprehensive. I said, Vicki, it won't go that fast. So she got in, and away she went. She never made the first part of the flying mile because the transmission came apart. Actually, the clutch came apart. And it wasn't her fault because afterward we looked at it and it was centrifugal failure of the clutch disc. And so no matter who was in the driver's seat, even if Buck had been in the driver's seat, probably the clutch would have failed.
So this was a three-speed manual transmission?
Yes, it was.
Was the car tan, Sahara sand, tan, the color?
The what?
Was the color of the car tan, Sahara sand?
Gosh, I don't even know that.
Because Ken Mack had an engineering mule car, 57, that he rebuilt. Did you know Ken Mack at Chrysler?
Yeah, I knew Ken.
Well, he had this car, which he got from some engineer who left it in a field for 40 years, and he rebuilt the thing with the manual transmission.
Well, Ken...
It was really a stripped-down car.
I know that Ken bought some engineering cars.
Yeah.
I don't know how many he bought, but it's entirely possible he bought that car.
Well, he said it had run at Daytona.
You know, that car had the short stack. I remember it had short pipes for each cylinder.
By the time he got it done, it had a different everything. I think the speedometer was original.
We'd have gone, Bob Graham's estimation, we'd have gone 150 miles an hour with the car, but we wouldn't have beat a Hot Rod magazine car called Suddenly. They had a modified Plymouth down there, and they went two ways, I think with
Granite Valley.
Oh, I can't remember the guy's name, but he was well-known driving up.
Granitella?
Anyway, I think they went 159 miles an hour.
Well, and Granitella.
So we wouldn't have won, but we'd have done, it'd been a respectable showing.
Bert, you mentioned earlier that the 55, 56 cars were the sleekest in the air.
The what?
The 55 and 56s were the sleekest in the
air. Oh yeah, aerodynamically they were a lot better. The 57, 58 were really aerodynamic. been having problems for trying to do a speed event. And 1960 was pretty good, but not as good as 55, 56.
Well, 57, it blew the trim off the top of the windshield.
Well, so did they in 61.
61.
Did they? 61.
In 61, 61. We would have seen
it.
I wasn't there. They used the 60 package in 61 car. And the first four cars were Chrysler 300s with pretty much a 60 package. And Greg won, and the other three cars were disqualified because the windshield molding flew off.
But they would have broken his 60 record if the windshield moldings had stayed on.
They would have, yes.
Yeah. I heard they ran faster, but they lost their molding.
Yeah.
It's probably in the book.
Greg Ziegler told me that when he went to pick up the 300F at the factory, that behind closed doors, that you people told him that it was closer to 450 horsepower. Is that true?
No. There was only this special about the engine.
This is a poster I went and picked up yesterday from a fellow by the name of Ron Silver, who had this. Greg Ziegler was Ron's godfather, Ron said. And so this is a poster he's had that he's donating to our club. And there's the 300G. Andy, I don't know if you can hold pitch that corner out there.
It's by the club.
You hold it, Andy, take a picture of it.
I'll hold it up over here.
The bottom corner of it, so.
Something's been censored.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure what that was back there. So.
That's got white walls anyway.
Yeah, it's white walls. And upcaps.
Yeah, wheel covers, you're right.
Did we have upcaps on the cars when you were running them down there?
Did what?
Were you running the hubcaps on the...
I think I'm wheel covered on.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's like it still has the chrome strip on the top.
Yeah.
The run going out.
Come on. Is this the one the fastest one?
This is the Greg Ziegler reference over here. 143.027.
He went 144.72.
So what's that one?
That's 61.
Oh. Okay. That's said by Greg Ziegler.
Yeah, when Greg drove both years.
Oh, he did. Okay, I see.
Maybe this was approved because this is one of the cars that the trim didn't fly off of.
Yeah.
The cars that the trim was lost on.
That's right.
Yeah. They ran 145, I think.
Right, they were faster.
Yes. 1960 was faster. Greg's car is the only one that completed the two ways with intact.
Okay. You had to finish with the whole car.
Right.
Okay. The whole car had to come across the line. Okay.
Yeah.
Somebody cut off the corner.
It's the metal and the rings.
I really lost track of Craig himself about the middle 90s, and this is a coincidence, but I was at my mother-in-law in Rockford, Illinois, and she was in a restaurant called Wesley Willows. Going into this resto. And I'm looking at the board that's got all the officials of Wesley Willows there, and it said, Chairman of the Board of Trustees, Greg Ziegler. And so through that, I was able to make contact with Greg, and we had dinner together several times at Wesley Willows, and quite a bit on the telephone. And he is a very good guy. By this time, he's no longer just a hardware dealer, he's also a banker. He had a bank in Elgin, so he'd moved along. And he was, one of our meetings at Wesley Willows, he wanted me to drive his new Mercedes, which was a V12.
Right.
And, so he Greg went on to be quite successful financially, I think.
That's the car he had when we saw.
Who was instrumental in the Ram induction? The Ram induction. Who was instrumental in that? You know, coming out with the cross ram. What engineer?
Oh, actually, I don't know. The taking the short, making the short branch ride out of the long one, came really from the Bob Graham, Ed Mason, and fuel injected experimental engine that they ran at Daytona. They had ram tubes on it. What we were trying to do is to use this, we had a 30 inch ram tube on the Chrysler 300F. What we're trying to do is shorten that to 15 inches because then that, instead of tuning it for around 2,500 or 3,000, tuned it at 5,000 RPM. And so what we did, in essence, is take out the casting, the web, and the first 15 inches, so we end up with what I call a plenum chamber, mm-hmm. and then the ram tubes. And so it really was kind of a derivative of the Ed Mason, Bob Graham package that they ran at Daytona. Huh.
Who came up with the original cross ram, the original cross ram idea? Do you know who developed that?
Well, I know it came from John Plattner's organization or department in, I shouldn't say that department, group within the engine lab. Okay. John Plattner was the guy who was the experimental engine guy, and he's actually the guy that built the engines for Indianapolis. Chrysler ran some V8s at Indianapolis, and John was in charge of building those. And I don't know if those used the ram tube principle or not, but the ramming, the long branch ram, would have come from John Plattner's office. I don't think it was anything revolutionary as far as 1960. It had been around for a number of years, but it's the first time it had been applied to a production automobile.
Didn't the Ram Chargers group develop that for their drag racing car?
The High and Mighty?
No, not drag racing. It didn't come out of drag racing.
Well, there was a group of engineers in Chrysler.
Oh, Tom Hoover?
Tom Hoover.
Yeah, the Ram Chargers.
Well, Tom made a lot of contributions. I don't know that he worked on the induction system. I think that pretty much is
they took the idea, but theirs was like what we call tunnel ram now. It wasn't actually a cross ram. They raised it straight up.
Yeah, well, yeah, I agree. It's the same principle. It's just the architecture.
And then they also, the drag racing group, made the 15-inch short ram, where it was one manifold instead of two. Yeah. And it had a big open panel. It was, like you say, but I had one of them. It wasn't any good until you got 3,600 RPM. It wouldn't even start.
The drag racing guys are interested in high end.
Yeah, that's what it did.
Right.
The longer that tube is, the farther down the RPM range.
You know, we didn't pay a lot of attention to the mile acceleration because it didn't get much publicity. But in 1960, the drivers used to get, and I used to get together at least once a day in kind of a meeting like this. And we had one of our meetings, we discussed the mile acceleration. And I was advocating 20 pounds of, we ran 60 pounds of air on the flying mile. And I was recommending 20 pounds of air in the rear tires for the mile acceleration. Because we want to get as much big a footprint as we can get when we're starting out, because that really counts. That time really counts. So the drivers were apprehensive about that. They didn't really like it too well. So I said, well, maybe, how big a benefit? They said, well, this help us. I said, well, I don't know, because all I'm telling you is what I think my recommendation based on experience. So they said, well, we're not going to do it without any more information than that, which was probably good judgment on their part. So I got Warren Coachling and two guys worked for me, Dale Moore and Gene Carr, and we went out after it was dark. We went down on the beach, and I stationed Gene Carr. It was about 1/8 of a mile apart. I stationed Gene Carr at one end, Dale at the other, with a flashlight to be sure there was nobody on the beach between us. Warren was driving, and I had a clipboard and a stopwatch. And we were going to run 1/8 mile or whatever the distance was. That wasn't important what the distance was, as long as it was the same for each run. So we were made a 60-pound tire run. That was the baseline. And then we were going to run a 40-pound. We ran the 40-pound, and now we're going to really run the 20-pound. And Dale and Gene with their flashlights would signal that it was okay, that there was nobody on the beach. And we aren't now by the pier. We're way south of the pier. So there are a few buildings, cottages there, but that's all. So anyway, we're just going to make the third run with 20 pounds of air, and the police said that. Because some of the people in the houses had called the police. And I had to convince them, Warren and I, he was an Eastern Airlines pilot, drove for a dealer called Cole Monroe and Monroe Zeter in Miami. Anyway, I had to convince the officer that we weren't drinking, that this was a test, and here's my clipboard, and here's my stopwatch, and so on. And we talked our way out of it. But we never found out the data, whether what I proposed was right or not. Greg had just won the flying mile, and he was, he believed in me. And so he put his tires down to 20 pounds pressure, and the way he won the mile acceleration. And he said he almost put the car in the ocean because it was so hard to control. So we still don't know to this day whether that's better or not.
Well, Andy, we'll have to get out there and buy clips, do some runs.